Bible, the Christian Old Testament, and the first book of the Deuteronomistic history, the story of Israel from the conquest of Canaan to the Babylonian exile. It tells of the campaigns of the Israelites in central, southern and northern Canaan, the destruction of their enemies, and the division of the land among the 12 tribes, framed by two set piece speeches, the first by God commanding the conquest of the land, and, at the end, the last by Joshua warning of the need for faithful observance of the law, Torah, revealed to Moses. Almost all scholars agree that the book of Joshua holds little historical value for early Israel and most likely reflects a much later period. The earliest parts of the book are possibly chapters 2 to 11, the story of the conquest. These chapters were later incorporated into an early form of Joshua written late in the reign of King Josiah, reign 640 to 609 BCE, but the book was not completed until after the fall of Jerusalem to the Neo-Babylonian Empire in 586 BCE. And possibly not until after the return from the Babylonian exile in 539 BCE. I transfer of leadership to Joshua, 1:1-18:2. Entrance into and conquest of Canaan, 2:1-12:24:3. Division of the land among the tribes, 13:1-22:34:4. Conclusion, 23:1-24:33. Chapter 1 commences after the death of Moses, Joshua 1:1. And presents the first of three important moments in Joshua marked with major speeches and reflections by the main characters. Here first God, and then Joshua, makes speeches about the goal of conquest of the promised land. In chapter 12, the narrator looks back on the conquest, and in chapter 23 Joshua gives a speech about what must be done if Israel is to live in peace in the land. God commissions Joshua to take possession of the land and warns him to keep faith with the covenant. God's speech foreshadows the major themes of the book: the crossing of the Jordan River and conquest of the land, its distribution, and the imperative need for obedience to the law. Joshua's own immediate obedience is seen in his speeches to the Israelite commanders and to the Transjordanian tribes, and the Transjordanians' affirmation of Joshua's leadership echoes Yahweh's assurances of victory. The Israelites cross the Jordan River through the miraculous intervention of God in the Ark of the Covenant. Then they are circumcised at Gibeath Harloth, translated as Hill of Foreskins, renamed Gilgal in memory. Gilgal sounds like Galilee, I have removed, but is more likely to translate as Circle of Standing Stones. The conquest begins in Canaan with Jericho, followed by Ai, central Canaan. After which Joshua builds an altar to Yahweh at Mount Ebal, northern Canaan, and renews the covenant. The covenant ceremony has elements of a divine land grant ceremony, similar to ceremonies known from Mesopotamia. The narrative then switches to the south. The Gibeonites trick the Israelites into entering an alliance with them by saying that they are not Canaanites. This prevents the Israelites from exterminating them, but they are enslaved instead. An alliance of Amorite kingdoms headed by the Canaanite king of Jerusalem is defeated with Yahweh's miraculous help of stopping the sun and the moon, and hurling down large hailstones. Joshua 10:10-14. The enemy kings were eventually hanged on trees. The Deuteronomist author may have used the then recent 701 BCE campaign of the Assyrian king Sennacherib in the kingdom of Judah as his model. The hanging of the captured kings is in accordance with Assyrian practice of the 8th century BCE. With the south conquered, the narrative moves to the northern campaign. A powerful multinational, or more accurately, multi-ethnic, coalition headed by the king of Hazor, the most important northern city, is defeated with Yahweh's help. Hazor itself is then captured and destroyed. Chapter 11 16-23 summarizes the extent of the conquest. Joshua has taken the entire land, almost entirely through military victories, with only the Gibeonites agreeing to peaceful terms with Israel. The land then had rest from war, Joshua 11:23, repeated at 14:15. Chapter 12 lists the vanquished kings on both sides of the Jordan River, the two kings who ruled east of the Jordan who were defeated under Moses' leadership, Joshua 12:1-6, cf. Numbers 21, and the 31 kings on the west of the Jordan who were defeated under Joshua's leadership, Joshua 12:7-24. The list of the 31 kings is quasi-tabular. Having described how the Israelites and Joshua have carried out the first of their God's commands, the narrative now turns to the second, to put the people in possession of the land. Joshua is old, advanced, or stricken, in years by this time, Joshua 13:1. This land distribution is a covenantal land grant. Yahweh, as king, is issuing each tribe its territory. The cities of refuge and Levitical cities are attached till the end, since it is necessary for the tribes to receive their grants before they allocate parts of it to others. The Transjordanian tribes are dismissed, affirming their loyalty to Yahweh. The book reaffirms Moses' allocation of land east of the Jordan to the tribes of Reuben and Gad and the half-tribe of Manasseh, Joshua 13:8-32, cf., and then describes how Joshua divided the newly conquered land of Canaan into parcels, and assigned them to the tribes by lot. Joshua 14:1 also makes reference to the role of Eleazar the priest, ahead of Joshua, in the distribution process. The description serves a theological function to show how the promise of the land was realized in the biblical narrative. Its origins are unclear, but the descriptions may reflect geographical relations among places named. The wording of suggests that the tribes of Reuben, Gad, Judah, Ephraim and Manasseh received their land allocation sometime before the remaining seven tribes, and a 21-member expedition set out to survey the remainder of the land with a view to organizing the allocation to the tribes of Simeon, Benjamin, Asher, Naphtali, Zebulun, Issachar, and Dan. Subsequently, 48 cities with their surrounding lands were allocated to the tribe of Levi, cf. Omitted in the Masoretic text, but present in the Septuagint, is a statement that by the end of chapter 21, the narrative records that the fulfillment of God's promise of land, rest and supremacy over the enemies of the Israelites was complete. Joshua 21:43-45. The writer of the letter to the Hebrews makes reference to Joshua and the promise of rest in. The tribes to whom Moses had granted land east of the Jordan are authorized to return home to Gilead, here used in the widest sense for the whole Transjordan district, having faithfully kept the charge Joshua 22:3, English Revised Version, of supporting the tribes occupying Canaan. They are granted riches, with very much livestock, with silver, with gold, with bronze, with iron, and with very much clothing as a reward, Joshua 22:1-9. Joshua, in his old age and conscious that he is going the way of all the earth, Joshua 23:14, gathers the leaders of the Israelites together and reminds them of Yahweh's great works for them, and of the need to love Yahweh, Joshua 23:11. The Israelites are told, just as Joshua himself had been told, Joshua 1:7, that they must comply with all that is written in the book of the law of Moses, Joshua 23:6, neither turning aside from it to the right hand or to the left, i.e. by adding to the law, or diminishing from it. Joshua meets again with all the people at Shechem in chapter 24 and addresses them a second time. He recounts the history of God's formation of the Israelite nation, beginning with Terah, the father of Abraham and Nahor, who lived beyond the Euphrates River and worshipped other gods. He invited the Israelites to choose between serving the Lord who had delivered them from Egypt, or the gods which their ancestors had served on the other side of the Euphrates, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land they now lived. The people chose to serve the Lord, a decision which Joshua recorded in the book of the law of God. He then erected a memorial stone under the oak that was by the sanctuary of the Lord in Shechem, Joshua 24:1-27. The oak is associated with the oak of Moreh where Abram had set up camp during his travels in this area, Genesis 12:6. Thus Joshua made a covenant with the people, literally cut a covenant, a phrase common to the Hebrew, Greek, and Latin languages. It derives from the custom of sacrifice, in which the victims were cut in pieces and offered to the deity invoked in ratification of the engagement. The people then returned to their inheritance, i.e. their allocated lands, Joshua 24:28. The book of Joshua closes with three concluding items, referred to in the Jerusalem Bible as two additions. There were no Levitical cities given to the descendants of Aaron and Ephraim, so theologians Carl Friedrich Keil and Franz Delitzsch suppose the land may have been at Geba in the territory of the tribe of Benjamin. The situation, upon the mountains of Ephraim, is not at variance with this view, as these mountains extended, according to Judges 4:5, etc., far into the territory of Benjamin. In some manuscripts and editions of the Septuagint, there is an additional verse relating to the apostasy of the Israelites after Joshua's death. The book of Joshua is an anonymous work. The Babylonian Talmud, written in the 3rd to 5th centuries CE, was the first attempt to attach authors to the holy books. Each book, according to the authors of the Talmud, was written by a prophet, and each prophet was an eyewitness of the events described, and Joshua himself wrote the book that bears his name. This idea was rejected as untenable by John Calvin, 1509-1564, and by the time of Thomas Hobbes 1588-1679, it was recognized that the book must have been written much later than the period it depicted. There is now general agreement that Joshua was composed as part of a larger work, the Deuteronomistic history, stretching from the book of Deuteronomy to the books of Kings. In 1943, the German biblical scholar Martin Noth suggested that this history was composed by a single author/editor, living in the time of the exile, 6th century BCE. A major modification to Noth's theory was made in 1973 by the American scholar Frank M. Cross, to the effect that two editions of the history could be distinguished, the first and more important from the court of King Josiah in the late 7th century BCE, and the second Noth's 6th century BCE exilic history. Later scholars have detected more authors or editors than either Noth or Cross allowed for. The prevailing scholarly view is that Joshua is not a factual account of historical events. The apparent setting of Joshua is the 13th century BCE. This was a time of widespread city destruction, but with a few exceptions, Hazor, Lachish, the destroyed cities are not the ones the Bible associates with Joshua, and the ones it does associate with him show little or no sign of even being occupied at the time. Given its lack of historicity, Carolyn Pressler in her commentary for the Westminster Bible Companion series suggests that readers of Joshua should give priority to its theological message, what passages teach about God, and be aware of what these would have meant to audiences in the 7th and 6th centuries BCE. Richard Nelson explains, the needs of the centralized monarchy favored a single story of origins, combining old traditions of an exodus from Egypt, belief in a national god as divine warrior, and explanations for ruined cities, social stratification and ethnic groups, and contemporary tribes. In scholarship prior to the early 20th century academic scholarship, the historicity of the early Israelite campaigns was taken for granted, for example, Paidim. However, by the 1930s Martin Noth issued what William F. Albright termed a sweeping criticism of the legitimacy of using biblical data in Joshua as material for history. Noth was a student of Albrecht Alt, who emphasized form criticism and the importance of etiology. Alt and Noth posited a peaceful movement of the Israelites into various areas of Canaan, contra the biblical account. Albright himself questioned the tenacity of etiologies, which were key to Noth's analysis of the campaigns in Joshua. Archaeological evidence in the 1930s showed that the city of Ai, an early target for conquest in the putative Joshua account, had existed and been destroyed, but in the 22nd century BCE. In 1951, Kathleen Kenyon showed that Jericho was from the Middle Bronze Age, circa 2100 to 1550 BCE, not the Late Bronze Age, circa 1550 to 1200 BCE. Kenyon argued that the early Israelite campaign could not be historically corroborated, but rather explained as an etiology of the location and a representation of the Israelite settlement. In 1955, G. Ernest Wright discussed the correlation of archaeological data to the early Israelite campaigns, which he divided into three phases per the Book of Joshua. He pointed to two sets of archaeological findings that seem to suggest that the biblical account is in general correct regarding the nature of the late 13th and 12th 11th centuries in the country, i.e., a period of tremendous violence. He gives particular weight to what were then recent digs at Hazor by Yigal'ya Dean. As an alternative to both the military conquest and uncontested infiltration hypotheses, George Mendenhall and Norman Gottwald suggested that the Israelites emerged through a kind of peasant revolt against their Canaanite lords. However, as explained by Gary A. Rendsburg, archaeological findings, presented by Israel Finkelstein in 1986, undermine this idea because the Israelites' first settled areas were not held by Canaanites, whose cities were sustained alongside Israelite areas. The Book of Joshua holds little historical value. The archaeological evidence shows that Jericho and Ai were not occupied in the Near Eastern Late Bronze Age. The story of the conquest most likely represents the nationalist propaganda of the 8th century BCE kings of Judah in their claims to the territory of the Kingdom of Israel, incorporated into an early form of Joshua written late in the reign of King Josiah, reign 640-609 BCE. The book was probably revised and completed after the fall of Jerusalem to the Neo-Babylonian Empire in 586 BCE, and possibly after the return from the Babylonian exile in 538 BCE. The overarching theological theme of the Deuteronomistic history is faithfulness and God's mercy, and their opposites, faithlessness and God's wrath. In the Book of Judges, the books of Samuel, and the books of Kings, the Israelites become faithless and God ultimately shows his anger by sending his people into exile. But in Joshua Israel is obedient, Joshua is faithful, and God fulfills his promise and gives them the land. Yahweh's war campaign in Canaan validates Israel's entitlement to the land and provides a paradigm of how Israel was to live there, 12 tribes, with a designated leader, united by covenant in warfare and in worship of Yahweh alone at a single sanctuary, all in obedience to the commands of Moses as found in the book of Deuteronomy. The book of Joshua takes forward Deuteronomy's theme of Israel as a single people worshiping Yahweh in the land God has given them. Yahweh, as the main character in the book, takes the initiative in conquering the land, and Yahweh's power wins the battles. For example, the walls of Jericho fall because Yahweh fights for Israel, not because the Israelites show superior fighting ability. The potential disunity of Israel is a constant theme, the greatest threat of disunity coming from the tribes east of the Jordan. Chapter 22:19 even hints that the land across the Jordan is unclean and that the tribes who live there have secondary status. Land is the central topic of Joshua. The introduction to Deuteronomy recalled how Yahweh had given the land to the Israelites but then withdrew the gift when Israel showed fear and only Joshua and Caleb had trusted in God. The land is Yahweh's to give or withhold, and the fact that he has promised it to Israel gives Israel an inalienable right to take it. For exilic and post-exilic readers, the land was both the sign of Yahweh's faithfulness and Israel's unfaithfulness, as well as the center of their ethnic identity. In Deuteronomistic theology, rest meant Israel's unthreatened possession of the land, the achievement of which began with the conquests of Joshua. Joshua carries out a systematic campaign against the civilians of Canaan, men, women and children, that amounts to genocide. In doing this he is carrying out harem as commanded by Yahweh in Deuteronomy 20:17, "You shall not leave alive anything that breathes." The purpose is to drive out and dispossess the Canaanites, with the implication that there are to be no treaties with the enemy, no mercy, and no intermarriage. The extermination of the nations glorifies Yahweh as a warrior and promotes Israel's claim to the land, while their continued survival explores the themes of disobedience and penalty and looks forward to the story told in Judges and Kings. The divine call for massacre at Jericho and elsewhere can be explained in terms of cultural norms. Israel was not the only Iron Age state to practice harem, and theology, a measure to ensure Israel's purity as well as the fulfillment of God's promise, but Patrick D. Miller in his commentary on Deuteronomy remarks, "There is no real way to make such reports palatable to the hearts and minds of contemporary readers and believers." Obedience versus disobedience is a constant theme of the work. Obedience ties in the Jordan crossing, the defeat of Jericho and Ai, circumcision and Passover, and the public display and reading of the law. Disobedience appears in the story of Achan, stoned for violating the harem command, the Gibeonites, and the altar built by the Transjordan tribes. Joshua's two final addresses challenge the Israel of the future, the readers of the story, to obey the most important command of all, to worship Yahweh and no other gods. Joshua thus illustrates the central Deuteronomistic message, that obedience leads to success and disobedience to ruin. The Deuteronomistic history draws parallels in proper leadership between Moses, Joshua, and Josiah. God's commission to Joshua in chapter 1 is framed as a royal installation. The people's pledge of loyalty to Joshua as the successor of Moses recalls royal practices. The covenant renewal ceremony led by Joshua was the prerogative of the kings of Judah. God's command to Joshua to meditate on the book of the law day and night parallels the description of Josiah in 2 Kings 23:25 as a king uniquely concerned with the study of the law. The two figures had identical territorial goals. Josiah died in 609 BCE while attempting to annex the former Israel to his own kingdom of Judah. Some of the parallels with Moses can be seen in the following, and not exhaustive, list. With the Zionist struggle for a Jewish state, the early Israelite campaigns have undergone renewed attention and interpretation. The early Zionists, according to Rachel Haverlock, read the book of Joshua as explaining their times and justifying their wars. From this perspective, God fought on behalf of manifest Israel. Joshua's vocabulary informed the lexicon of Jewish nationalism. Later, in 1958, David Ben-Gurion saw the biblical war narrative as constituting an ideal basis for a unifying myth of national identity. This was a unity that was framed against a common enemy, the Arabs beyond Israel's borders. Ben-Gurion met with politicians and scholars, such as Bible scholar Shamar Yahu Tilmon, to discuss the conquest in Joshua. He later published a book of the meeting transcripts. In a lecture at Ben-Gurion's home, archaeologist Yigelia Dean argued for the historicity of the Israelite military campaign and remarked on how much easier it was for military experts to appreciate the plausibility of the Joshua narrative. Yadin specifically pointed to the conquests of Hazor, Bethel, and Lachish. Conversely, archaeologist Yohanan Aharoni argued against the historicity of the early Israelite campaigns, instead favoring a migration model. Rachel Haverlock herself argues that the myth of conquest, although shaped by ardent nationalists with a military agenda, could be reinterpreted for the purposes of a decentralized post-nationalism. By the same token, the biblical narrative of conquest has been used as an apparatus of critique against Zionism. For example, Michael Pryor criticizes the use of the campaign in Joshua to favor colonial enterprises, in general, not only Zionism, and have been interpreted as validating ethnic cleansing. He asserts that the Bible was used to make the treatment of Palestinians more palatable morally. A related moral condemnation can be seen in the political sacralization of imperial genocide, contextualizing Timothy Dwight's The Conquest of Canaan by Bill Templer. This kind of critique is not new. Jonathan Boyerin notes how Frederick W. Turner blamed Israel's monotheism for the very idea of genocide, which Boyerin found simplistic yet with precedence. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.